Good evening. I'm Jim McKay, welcoming you to a party, to a celebration, if you will, of the 20th anniversary of ABC's Wide World of Sports. During the next hour and a half, you'll be seeing some of the athletes we've met along the way and reliving some of the great moments. It's been a long trip, really. We've gone from Alan Shepard in that first tiny space capsule to the mammoth space shuttle. And as I say, we've had a lot of adventures along the way. But it all started on April 29th, 1961. Like this. I'm Jim McKay at Franklin Field in Philadelphia for the 67th annual Penn Relay Carnival. Each Saturday for the next 20 weeks, we'll be taking our cameras to the scene of famous sports events all over the world. A new series crossing new horizons in sports. Sports, in its unending variety, unfolds on ABC's Wide World of Sports, capturing the sight and sound, the emotion, the beauty and history-making achievements wherever men gather to compete in this great wide world of athletics.
Who would have thought that the 20-week series would stretch to 20 years? Or that in that first summer, we would take 20 tons of equipment and half a hundred engineers to Moscow to see a U.S.-Soviet track meet and to watch wonderful Wilma Rudolph.
Canova taking it, jumping over, out in front, and Rudolph giving it everything. Here she comes, Wilma Rudolph, Wilming, leading her way to the finish line. She's going to make it.
Who could have predicted that we would be the first network sports department to visit Castro's Cuba for a volleyball game? Or that Castro himself would end up translating for his interpreter.
Can you tell me what the commandante said?
Dice, el comandante dice que él
cree. In English.
We were first in network sports to visit the People's Republic of China, too, for gymnastics. But while we were there, we saw the wall and met the people and found a surprising friendliness everywhere we went. We were up at dawn with our cameras to watch thousands of Chinese taking their morning exercise in the great square. Among them, the old people practicing the ancient art of Tai Chi. We journeyed up the Danube on our way to Vienna in 1967 and saw those famous castles. In Vienna, in the last World Championships of figure skating held outdoors, we watched and marveled at the artistry of Ludmila and Oleg Protopopov, world pairs champions from the Soviet Union. Who might have guessed that in time they would defect and do their skating in the United States? Or that 12 years later, we would return to Vienna to watch the young Americans, Ty Babylonia and Randy Gardner, win the championship that the Protopopovs had worn so well. We found summertime sentiment back home in Indiana as the balloons rose to the sky signifying the start of the Indianapolis 500. We watched the great drivers compete, from A.J. Foyt to Jim Clark and Johnny Rutherford to Mario Andretti, here winning in 1969 and getting for his reward a kiss from car owner Andy Granatelli. Who would have thought that we would visit Las Vegas, where the neon lights and flashing incandescent bulbs obscure the beauty of the western sunset, not for the shows or the gambling, but for sport, ranging from rodeos to boxing, especially boxing. WBC champion Larry Holmes here. But we also saw Muhammad Ali and Sugar Ray Leonard and many more. We've seen the wide world, all right, but no sunset anywhere looks better than the ones we see arriving back home in New York. And no castle on the Rhine or great sculpture in Italy ever looks quite as good as the Statue of Liberty when the plane lowers over Manhattan on its way to LaGuardia or JFK, and we know that we're almost home again. Still, who would have thought 20 years ago that we'd have a night like this, when the great athletes we've seen would gather with us as the sun sets on Park Avenue to recall the times that have been, athletes like O.J. Simpson and Mario Andretti. Wilma Rudolph still looking wonderful 20 years later. 1968 decathlon champion Bill Toomey. Eric Heiden, he of the five gold medals. Fred Pierce, president of ABC Television, is with us. And so is the great mile runner Jim Ryan. Dr. and Mrs. Greg Jenkins, she's Peggy Fleming. Mr. and Mrs. Arthur Ashe. Susan Anton is here to sing. Mr. and Mrs. Muhammad Ali
They've all come to Park Avenue in the Waldorf, where Winston Churchill spoke and Elsa Maxwell gave a party for Cole Porter, where presidents and astronauts have gathered, where the Explorers Club has feasted on quail eggs and hippopotamus, and where tonight we'll toast that 20-year journey through the wide world of sports. Spanning the globe to bring you the constant variety of sport. The thrill of victory. And the agony of defeat. The human drama of athletic competition. Tonight we celebrate 20 years of ABC's Wide World of Sports.
This special 20th anniversary edition of ABC's Wide World of Sports is brought to you by Michelob Light, an exceptional light beer with a rich, smooth taste. By Cellini Cologne, created in Italy by Fabergé, where life is for living and loving. Viva Cellini. And by the Continental Insurance Companies and their 12,000 agents throughout the U.S.
How do you describe Cellini Cologne for men? As Italian, as vino suave. Cellini, as Italian as amore in the afternoon. As Italian as a macchina sportiva. Cellini, as Italian as a calcio game in the street. Cellini Cologne was created in Italy where life is for living and loving. Viva Cellini by Fabergé.
Babe, a little one-on-one.
I had to do some yard work.
For a Michelob Light?
I don't have to do any yard work.
Would good friends really go at it this hard just for a beer? Well, consider it's Michelob Light. And that means a rich, smooth taste you can compare to any beer you like.
102 to 98. How did you do it? Defense?
Michelob Light. Compare the taste.
Ladies and gentlemen, from the Grand Ballroom of the Waldorf Astoria in New York, Mr. Jim McKay.
Thank you. To tell you why we are here, we simply have to say who is here. And who is here are the people who made ABC's Wide World of Sports, after 20 years, what it is. The longest running, most successful sports series in the history of television. And those people range from Leonard Goldenson, who had faith in his little old raggle-taggle sports department back in 1961, to Roone, who, of course, produced all those shows in the early days personally, and still the guiding spirit of everything we do, to the men and women of the ABC sports production team, week after week and year after year, and 36, 48 hours at a time sometimes, to broadcast operations and engineering, Julie Barnathan's people, to, yes, indeed, the commentators who have spoken some of the finest English sentences ever heard. The sales guys have gone out and have sold the commercials, without which we wouldn't be on the air. John Lazarus and his men. But primarily the people who have made this show and the people we want to honor tonight are the athletes, because it's been through them that we've had the grist for our mill, we have had the stories to tell, we have the wonderful things to see. These athletes who through their dedication, through their talent, and through their personality also have made Wide World of Sports what it is.
Where in the wide world they would come from, we never could predict. Those ones with the extra human contact, the ones we came to know by their first names, like friends. This was Olga.
Her name is Olga Korbut of the Soviet Union, and you must remember how she burst on the world at the Olympics, doing things on the slender balance beam that made you hold your breath. On the uneven bar, she did maneuvers never seen in a championship before. And in the floor exercises, she was like a happy, talented child playing in the sun. I asked her in Munich what she would like most to see in America.
Вообще не знаю. Но я бы очень хотела побывать в Нью-Йорке.
I simply don't know. I really can't tell what I would like to see. But what I would like to see probably was New York.
She wanted to see New York. And now on this early spring weekend, she is here.
The same routine as that Monday
night.
All right,
now here it comes. No margin for error. Back, Summy Cat. She did it again. And watch this free drop into a hip circle. There's just no let up in this exercise. Pivot, stomach whip, drop kip, and the dismount.
That was Olga. They came in different sizes and colors and spoke many different tongues. Edson Arantes do Nascimento, known to the world as Pelé, here leading Brazil to the World Cup Soccer Championship in Mexico, 1970. When his career seemed over, he came to America and built the sport with the power of his personality, then played his farewell game one rainy day in New Jersey.
Please say to me, say with me, three times, love. Love. And love. Thank you very much. Muito obrigado.
Yes, love is what this day is about. The love of this man for a game and his love for the children of the world who play it. The love of hundreds of millions of people around the world for this warm and simple man who so obviously believes what he said. Join us as we say farewell to Pelé.
Pelé celebrated the day the way he knew best.
Pelé with a hard shot into the goal! A shot into the goal! Pelé has scored in his last half for the Cosmos. And this is what today is all about. The music is Auld Lang Syne, but it isn't New Year's Eve because there's no tomorrow in the career of Pelé. No New Year coming, not as far as that playing career is concerned. But we said the story was about love today. There it is, the love of the man for the people, the love of the people for the man, the kind of a hero we all want to see.
Then there was Arnie, as in Palmer, enlisting all of Scotland as recruits in his army the day they almost crushed him with admiration at Troon.
Wait a minute. Here he comes. He made it. And I hope that that is a mock limp Palmer's putting on as he finally gets up to the 18th grade.
Kel Nagel made a great putt, and then...
Now, Arnold Palmer, with about a 20-footer. He could play this pretty safely, lag it up, get his par four, and break the record by a shot. Hello?
And he made it! Arnold Palmer breaks the record for the British Open by two shots with a total of 276.
The word is used in horse racing and boxing and in life. And Smoke and Joe always had it, in victory or defeat, in good times or bad. The word is class.
Frazier giving it to him and giving it to him. A right there. A left that missed, another right that missed. Down goes Ellis. Down goes Ellis.
And Joe Frazier had won the title. Later, Howard would unconsciously echo that phrase he used when Joe lost his title to George Foreman one night on the island of Jamaica.
I think he hurt Joe Frazier. I think Joe is hurt. Angie Dundee, Ali's trainer right next to me, is saying it. You may hear him. Down goes Frazier! Down goes Frazier! Down goes Frazier!
Yes, it's been a long trip for Smokin' Joe, from working in a Philadelphia slaughterhouse to the heavyweight championship of the world to the permanent place he holds tonight with the other great personalities of sport. You'll meet many more as we celebrate 20 years of Wide World of Sport.
Fortunately, the man who owns this business is covered by Continental Insurance. We're experts at lowering risks, which can also lower premiums. We found that the way he stored his chemicals could have been deadly. We advised a new, safer way. And this disaster never happened. Maybe we can stop something from happening to you. Call a Continental agent about your business or home.
Time now. Action. Creation of a new personal sport coupe. Ford EXP. The bringing together of you and a beautiful package of world-class technologies. With front-wheel drive, four-wheel independent suspension, a shape that slices the wind, and built with Ford's commitment to quality. Tomorrow is here. The 1982 EXP from the world of Ford.
RCA, am I glad I waited for convertible select division? Because now I have two videotape recorders in one. Wait till Quigley sees this. It records our favorite TV shows. It's got remote control, special effects like stop action, and it converts to a portable. So you can videotape most anywhere, or anything. And you get an instant playback on TV. Convertible select division. RCA, it was really worth waiting for.
Let RCA turn your television into select division.
Sunday on Those Amazing Animals, fire ants invade the U.S. A man serenades killer whales, and a vulture becomes a pet. And Monday on That's Incredible, stuntmen pit car against motorcycle in a tunnel of fire, and a master of martial arts risks it all.
Here on ABC.
We've seen courage and daring displayed in many ways in many places on Wide World. Consider the men who climbed the Eiffel Tower one Sunday afternoon to celebrate its 75th anniversary.
The last thing these men do will be to hang out over the city of Paris with their backs literally facing the street and surmount the final overhang. That will be the most difficult part of the climb. It will come, obviously, when they are most tired. Again, a good look at Paris in the background here, the beautiful buildings of this loveliest of all cities. Been described as looking like a woman with flowers in her hair.
As they climbed the Northwest Pillar, using the rivet heads for footholds, the mountaineers paused at each level, once for some lunch and a bottle of wine, then finally were up and over. That was a scheduled climb. But George Willig's ascent of the World Trade Center in New York was strictly his own idea. We followed George after that, and we're televising live from Angel's Landing in Zion National Park when Bill Fleming described a shocking moment. George was very near the top, but suddenly in trouble.
Oh, my God.
George, are you all right?
Yep.
You okay, George?
Yep.
You sure?
Yep.
Hang on for a second. Check yourself.
Don't even try to talk.
Just knocked the wind out of me.
Just hang there for a minute, George.
Yeah, I'm fine.
George Willig's near disaster, some 1,400 feet above the base of Angel's Landing. After catching his breath, he finished the climb. There was the Frenchman, Philippe Petit, walking a tightrope between the towers of a French cathedral. He told us why he does it.
I love to climb, I love to live my life, and here in the middle of that white, you really feel that you live, because you are carrying your life from one side to another. To feel myself living, that's the main thing, but on the other way, there is also, I love to do shows, I love to show myself.
My name is Evel Knievel. I'm a professional daredevil.
It's been 6.5 years now since Evil made good on his boast to try to cross a canyon on a machine he called a sky cycle. It was an attempt doomed to failure, but one of the happenings of the mid-1970s.
He had a premature chute. You have a good chute on you.
Come on.
Stay with the vehicle. Stay with the vehicle. Put your visor up if you can.
The end of the flight of Evil, but he had at last made the attempt and come out uninjured. Later in London, he was not so lucky. Although badly hurt, he insisted on walking out of the stadium that day, later recovered and jumped again. There was the moral courage of baseball star Curt Flood, pioneering the cause of players' rights in his suit against the reserve clause. It ended a great career.
Well, it's been said and it's been written, Curt, that you're a man who makes $90,000 a year, which isn't exactly slave wages. What you were taught to that?
Well, Howard, I'm a well-paid slave is nonetheless a slave.
We've seen the courage of the downhill racer, a special breed of athlete who pits his skill and concentration against a snow-covered mountainside, but still must hope, like a gambler, for luck, because one unseen rock or rut can cost even the expert the race, or possibly his life. Jean-Claude Killy's performance and personality summed up the beauty and the glamour of ski racing. One day in Vail, Colorado, 16 years ago, Jean-Claude flew down the hill in a pink shirt. It was a moment that said a lot about the sport, the man, and the special flair of a Frenchman. Here he was winning a world championship in Chile the following year as Wide World followed him to South America. This was Phil Mayer in a World Cup race on Lake Placid Whiteface Mountain less than a year before the 1980 Winter Olympics. He was America's top Olympic skiing hope, but after this run, many thought that his career was over. He seemed to be going well, but then he suddenly fell and broke his left ankle badly. To reassemble the ankle required a metal plate and seven screws. There you see it. Almost unbelievably, he recuperated, trained hard, and came back to win a silver medal in those Olympics. Then this season became the first American ever to win the overall World Cup championship. We recall the courage of our 1968 Athlete of the Year, Bill Toomey, as he won the decathlon in the Mexico City Olympics at age 29. Here is Bill Toomey, running in the footsteps of Jim Thorpe and Rafer Johnson and Bob Mathias. Running in the cold and the dark of Mexico City, in the breathless air, winning the decathlon.
Bill Toomey, in a memorable moment of sportsmanship with Kurt Bendelin of Germany, he had overcome age and the early handicap of a serious hand problem. And he's with us tonight.
Congratulations to ABC, and it's a superb evening. I mean, I just have to say that this is one of the most outstanding evenings that I've had in a long time. And I really want to thank everybody here for, you know, I guess ABC has done more for the Olympic movement than any organization in America outside of the U.S. Olympic Committee. They have made heroes out of unknown people. I lived in a closet for 8 years training, and all of a sudden I was a somebody. But I have to congratulate not only the fact that they covered, but the creativity and the way they covered with tremendous sensitivity. And in 20 years of television, ABC has not only led the way, they have created a situation whereby they have initiated imitators to follow in their footsteps. Rune, you've done a tremendous job. Jim, the years you've spent have not been wasted. You have brought amateur sports to America, and it is because of the work that ABC has done that we have athletes to follow in the footsteps of the great athletes that are here tonight. Thank you all for coming.
Thank you, man.
Spirited new men's cologne and aftershave, as brisk and bold as the open sky.
Blue Stratos.
Blue Stratos, for the free spirit in man.
Unleash the spirit. Unleash the spirit. Blue Stratos.
Do you know me? I won a few gold medals in the 1968 Olympics as an amateur. But skiing for me now is a business. And for that, I need an American Express card, and for the receipts that they send back with the bill. Believe me, those records are easier to keep than speed records in the downhill.
To apply for a card, look for this display wherever the card is welcomed.
The American Express card. Don't leave home without it.
Celebrate the most exciting 2 minutes in sports, the Kentucky Derby, Saturday, May 2nd on ABC.
Celebrate.
Come to All-American Country, WTNJ, FM 106.
Country music will never be the same. Hi, I'm Ross Moranti, and I hope you'll join us for Moranti & Company every weekday morning from 6 to 10 a.m. on WTNJ, FM 106, as we bring you the best in music, information, and fun. Weekday mornings at 6 on WTNJ.
WTNJ, FM 106. All-American Country.
Don't forget to turn your clock ahead 1 hour tonight.
In the winter of 1962, this young man from North Carolina achieved an honor that can never be taken away from him. One night in the Los Angeles Sports Arena, Jim Beatty became, for all time, the first man ever to run a mile in less than 4 minutes indoors, and thereby became our first athlete of the year. Watch him, baby, pulling it on. Here comes the gun lap. Watch him go, turning on the sprint.
He's turning up. He's riding right at 4 minute pace, Jim. He's very good. Close to 4 minutes. Sensationally close.
You may be seeing track history right here and now. He still has about 40 yards to go.
He's going
to
make it. He's going to run the first 4 minute mile.
The official time, 3:58.9, the first indoor sub-4-minute mile. We've seen many firsts on Wide World. Don Jackson in Prague trying a jump never landed before, as we watched with Dick Button.
He is going to open his program with a triple Lutz jump, three revolutions from a Lutz position, the first ever done in world competition. Let's see how he does it. He has planned it. Let's see what happens. Here it comes. A beautiful triple Lutz. It's fantastic.
Every time we saw Valery Brumel of the Soviet Union, he seemed to be the first to clear a new height. He set world high jump records on our telecasts in 1961 and 62, and again in 63.
Valery Brumel of the Soviet Union has set another new world record for the third year in a row, 7 feet 5 3/4 inches. To the applause of many tens of thousands of people here at Lenin Stadium in Moscow, applauded by Khrushchev and Ambassador Harriman.
A.J. Foyt is the first and only man to win four Indy 500s, but in 1967, he was first to achieve an unusual double. First, he would take the 500, but not before a stunning last lap crash almost deprived him of victory.
And there's an accident in the front straightaway!
Two, three, four cars! Where's Foyt? I don't know whether he can get through or not. Hitting the wall! Bouncing back across the straightaway!
Foyt's only got a couple hundred yards to go, but where is he?
There he is! He's going to get through. A.J. Foyt will win the Indianapolis 500 in an incredible, thrilling finish.
A fortnight later, he participated in the famous running start, now a thing of the past, at the 24 Hours of Le Mans in France. He had very little experience making the right and left turns of a road course or in driving a race at night. But he and his co-driver, Dan Gurney, another American, won the 24 Hours, and A.J. was the master of Indy and Le Mans, the first to achieve it. It was a mark of the changes in our society when Renee Richards became the first transsexual to play championship women's tennis and told us about it.
I've been through a great deal in my life personally, and I've been through a great deal as a physician. And this, although it's a very big strain, I have to admit that emotionally, psychologically, for me in front of all these people in this setting, is not the kind of strain that is going to destroy me, because no strain of this type can destroy me.
There was the huge, haughty Vasily Alexeyev, becoming the first human ever to lift more than a quarter ton, as our longtime colleague Bob Beatty called it.
But now, the big thing. Can he become the first man to lift a quarter of a ton, 500 pounds? Hey, here's the clean. Russia has just lifted 501 and a half pounds. The first man ever in competition to lift over 500 pounds.
And there was the tiny Kathy Rigby in Yugoslavia. Up until that day, no American, male or female, had ever won a medal of any kind in the World Gymnastics Championships. It was another first.
A slight error there, that may cause a 1-2-tenth deduction. But this is the only error so far in the routine. And a full twisting front somersault. A great exercise.
Kathy Rigby of the United States has made her effort. Kathy Rigby is the first person from her country to win a medal of any kind in the World Gymnastics Championship. There she is. The first American gold medal would come 8 years later in France. Kurt Thomas suddenly with a chance for the title.
Double back?
Boy.
Boy, he's laying it in. Now watch this as Thomas Flair on the floor.
You think they're paying attention in Terre Haute, Indiana?
Oh. The crowd loves him. Listen to the reaction. My God, Jim, if this kid comes home with a gold medal,
That's what it looks like right now, unless there's a big mistake.
He needs to hit a double twister. That's all he needs. Now nail it. Kurt Thomas! Maybe a gold medal! All right, America, you got him!
Yes, Kurt Thomas won the gold. And so at the same championships in Strasbourg did Marsha Frederick of Connecticut. The quiet teenager won the first American gold in women's competition with this performance on the uneven bars. And speaking of firsts, the first time we saw Nadia Comaneci, she was an unknown 13-year-old at the European Championships in Norway, 1975. She wasn't unknown for long, winning 4 gold medals and a silver for Romania. The name of the music had not yet been changed to Nadia's theme. That would come at the Olympics, when she would get 7 perfect marks. But the first 10 we saw her achieve was at the American Cup in New York. It was just a few months before the Olympics. And by now, the former gymnast Kathy Rigby was our commentator.
Here's her last tumbling run. A double twist. Beautiful. Look at the height on that.
She had achieved that rarity, a perfect mark, and there were many more to come. She became our athlete of the year for 1976. Nadia, who made the number 10 famous long before Bo Derek came along.
Fact, you're about to witness an act of violence. Brute force exploding, unleashing friction at its worst. Because when you start a cold engine, it's barely protected by motor oil. What can you do? Fact, use the black oil Arco Graphite. The oil with graphite. The lubricant that makes Arco Graphite reduce friction better than any other leading oil. Arco Graphite, the oil that's fact, not friction. Look for Arco Graphite's $1.80 refund offer.
It started these 5 cars all at once. These cars were left in Yankee Stadium with their lights on. It batted 1,000. The Sears Die Hard, now with even more power to start your car than ever before. And from the people who brought you the battery you can count on, comes the muffler you can count on. Muzzler, the aluminized muffler that's only $19.99 installed. For the power you can count on, for the price you can count on Sears.
How about Michelob Light for the winners?
Sure, but we get mighty thirsty.
Would a bunch of guys really go at it this hard just for a beer? Well, consider, it's Michelob Light, and that means a rich, smooth taste you can compare to any beer you like.
Those guys could have beaten the Russians today. You think they'd play us for a Michelob Light?
Michelob Light, compare the taste.
Can it really be 17 years since we first saw Peggy Fleming? It was in a dark and drafty arena in Cleveland at the U.S. National Championships. This is Peggy Fleming, 15 years old from Pasadena, California. The big surprise of this championship so far. She has never participated in the National Senior Championship at all. She never won a national novice title or a national junior title. But she's in third place at the end of the school figures, and reputedly, her free skating is the best part of her repertoire. Well, Peggy won, and 4 years later was Olympic champion when she skated in the Worlds at Geneva.
First, a spread eagle, look at the line of the body. Now a double axel. Another spread eagle.
By satellite what could be the farewell amateur performance of Peggy Fleming of the United States here in Geneva, Switzerland. Peggy Fleming is still very much skating professionally. She is the wife of Dr. Greg Jenkins, the mother of 4-year-old Andrew, and here she is. Peggy?
Thank you very much, Jim. First of all, I'd like to thank Wide World of Sports for the coverage of figure skating for all the years. And I don't think that figure skating would be as popular as it is if it wasn't for this show. And I'd also like to tell you how much I appreciate and admire all the people connected with ABC Sports. They are so competent and so passionate for all of our sports, and they are very, very understanding. And I admire that very, very much and appreciate that. And I wish you all, you know, a very happy 20th anniversary, and I look forward to watching Wide World of Sports for decades to come. Thank you.
Janet Lynn never won a world or Olympic gold medal, but her free skating and her personality won her the love of crowds everywhere, as here in Lyon, France, when she was destined to finish fourth.
Listen to this.
Janet Lynn. They loved her in Lyon as they did back home in Rockford, Illinois. The crowd in Munich was booing the marks of the previous skater, but Dorothy Hamill thought they were booing her as she took to the ice in the World Championships at age 17.
Dorothy Hamill was really shaken by it, and it looked to us like she was crying, and still is. It's a really tough break for the American girl trying for a World Championship, and I would have to say a bad performance on the part of the crowd. Now, they were going to give her a rest period, but she said, no, I'm going to go out and do it. I'm going to do it now.
That's what it means by being an up and down girl. This girl is up when the pressure is on, and that's why she will probably now skate one of the best performances of her career. And a flying camel, and watch the ending. Watch as she drops from this back camel position, taps the ice, and turns into a back sit spin in what is called a Hamill camel.
And as she finishes, just watch and listen to what happens.
Well, Dorothy conquered the crowd and her own emotions and won the silver medal that year and won the Olympics in 1976. America's next queen of the ice was Linda Frattiani. Here you see her winning a world championship at age 16 in Tokyo, 1977. She won again in 79 and took a silver in the 80 Olympics.
Double axel into a double toe loop. That's okay. That's okay.
And now comes Elaine Zayac. Dick Button did the first triple jump. Don Jackson did the first triple Lutz. This 15-year-old does seven triples in a four-minute performance.
It's a very tough combination at the end of a four-minute routine. Another triple toe loop. She can do a triple out of just about anything.
Well, it may be standing ovation time from this American crowd, and so it is. We're on the feet again. It's time for Elaine Zayac.
As we have looked at America's skating queens, we must look back also to the Soviet Union's queen of the ice, Irina Rodnina, world pairs champion 10 times, Olympic champion 3 times, and this unprecedented occurrence in 1973.
And I believe something has happened. Their music has stopped. They must be on a tape, and the tape must have broken.
Although the music had stopped, they skated on, accompanied only by the growing applause of the crowd, for almost three more minutes. There had never been anything like it. The judges huddled, signaled them that they could stop and begin again, but they skated on. In the end, it was clear that they were going to win without music.
And that's the end of the program.
Well, you're watching something that has never happened before in the World Figure Skating Championship. I listen to the crowd.
Irina Rodnina performing like the champion she was that night in Bratislava. The great American skating story of today is Scott Hamilton. He won the world championship this winter in Hartford, Connecticut. This 22-year-old, 5'3" tall. His growth was stunted by Schwachman syndrome as a child. But Scotty has conquered it all, and he treats it with a smile, never mentioning that he almost died when he was 6.
The last blazer I bought had a duck on the pocket. It's just things like that, you know, I'd really like to get through. You know, skating was one thing, but not being able to date Susan Anton's another thing. That really concerns me.
Well, Scotty, would you stand up? There he is. Now look. Look, kid. All I can say is this. Dating is purely a matter between you and Susan. I can't do anything about that. However, we thought that since you're here, you might as well like to meet her. Ladies and gentlemen, about to approach table 11, where Scotty is sitting, is Susan Anton, who is going to entertain you. Susan.
Scotty!
very best to embarrass you terribly in front of all of these people. You're so cute. You know, I was watching. I was at the Riviera Hotel in Las Vegas when I saw the... Did you get the letter?
I got the letter. Did you get mine?
I didn't get yours.
I sent one to Dudley, too.
Oh, well, what did it say? Tell us.
Well...
Should I wait till I get the letter?
Yeah, it's pretty hot.
Yeah? I told Scott, I said, good things come in small packages because I happen to be dating a man that's only 5'2½". So, obviously, wonderful things could come in good packages. And we have a little song here just for you, Scott. You must have been a beautiful baby. You must have been a wonderful child. When you were starting to go to kindergarten, I bet you drove a little girl's wild. Well, when it comes to winning gold medals, you showed everyone you know how. And when they handed you the prize, the world cheered, so did I.
Ford Escort now shows you another face, the sporty Ford Escort SS. It shows its stripes, pulls with front-wheel drive, handles with rack and pinion steering, smooths with four-wheel independent suspension, informs and invites. The sporty Ford Escort SS, built in America to take on the world and doing it.
How do you describe Cellini Cologne for men? As Italian as Vino Suave. Cellini, as Italian as Amore in the afternoon. As Italian as a macchina sportiva. Cellini, as Italian as a calcio game in the street. Cellini Cologne was created in Italy where life is for living and loving. Viva Cellini by Fabergé.
Fortunately, this crate belongs to a man who's covered by Continental Insurance. We're experts at lowering risks, which can also lower premiums. So we checked the way he loaded his crates on his truck. We found it dangerous. We advised the new, safer way. And this accident never happened. Maybe we can stop something from happening to you. Call a Continental agent about your business or home.
As Wide World of Sports celebrates its 20th anniversary here in New York, we think of how far from Broadway we've traveled in miles and moves. This is Sarajevo, where East and West live side by side. Ruled for hundreds of years by the Turks, now part of communist Yugoslavia, but still a blend of religious beliefs. This is the cry of the Muslim. There is but one God, and his name is Allah, and Muhammad is his prophet. The bazaar is the kind of a place where you would not be at all surprised to see the ghosts of Sidney Greenstreet and Peter Lorre walking through the stalls, searching for the missing icon, or the water pipe containing the stolen jewels. To Cape Town, South Africa, and the Soweto district in 1977, went Arthur Ashe, a great tennis player, going this time as a reporter and bringing us an incisive analysis of segregation there as it relates to sports.
In the Dutch or Afrikaans language of South Africa, there is a word pronounced apartheid, which simply means a policy to keep people of different races apart, not as a matter of custom or preserving ethnic flavor in certain neighborhoods, but rather as the law of this beautiful land.
Hello, I'm Arthur Ashe. Born in Richmond, Virginia, and now living in Miami, Florida, whenever I'm there. I'm a tennis player, so I travel a lot. Now I'm in Johannesburg, South Africa, in a tennis stadium called Ellis Park. I first played here in 1973 in the South African Open. As a matter of fact, I lost the final to none other than Jimmy Connors. I recall looking up from the court that day to see two railings, one over there and one right here that separated white from black. But now, the hole is here, but the railing is gone. And the seating is mixed, and the toilets outside are mixed, the restaurant is mixed, the parking is mixed. In fact, the place is integrated inside these walls. But outside these walls, South African society today is like this stadium was in 1973. It's white over there, and it's black over here.
Wonderful Copenhagen really is a summer festival in the year of 1969, particularly out on the somewhat choppy waters of Lake Bogsværd, where this sort of thing has been happening all week.
To understand Attica, one must go back into recent history, September 1971, when the very word Attica became a national byword. Because a riot took place here, inmates took over this correctional facility, as they call it.
A young guard named William Quinn, who had been notable for excusing minor violations in the past and was regarded as a friendly guard, was nonetheless struck down, the skull fractured in two different places. 2 days later, tragically, William Quinn died. He was the only facility officer who was killed in the takeover of the prison by the inmates.
The event we televised in Attica was the Harlem Globetrotters. How different the mood was later when we followed them to the world capital of country music. Just another first for the legendary Harlem Globetrotters, doing their magic circle on the stage of the Grand Ole Opry to the accompaniment of real country music.
It's the northernmost capital in the world, up in the shadow of the Arctic Circle. Bubbling hot springs. There are thousands of these all over the island of Iceland. And there are geysers, too, and volcanoes, such as Surtsey, that erupted some 10 years ago.
The loneliest man in Reykjavik, Iceland, on the 11th day of July in 1972, was Russia's Boris Spassky. On that day, Washington Post reporter Bob Woodward had his first meeting with the White House source known as Deep Throat. But Boris Spassky came to play Bobby Fischer for the World Chess Championship. Bobby wasn't there, enough to make a man feel rejected. Cameras were there, however, to record Spassky's first move, which was pawn to queen four. These are the only films of that strange day. In time, the long wait of Boris Spassky was rewarded with the appearance of his youthful challenger. Sorry, Bobby said, got caught in traffic. Traffic in Iceland, Boris may have thought. It looked like all was well until Bobby eventually spotted the camera hidden away in an unobtrusive spot. As you will see, he protested, then played and lost to Spassky. Next day, Bobby flat refused to play and forfeited. He lost the battle, but won the war more than a month and a half later. He took away Spassky's title on September 1st. Since then, Fischer has been stripped of his title in another chess controversy.
Foggy day in London town had me low and it had me down. I viewed the morning with much alarm. The British Museum, it lost its charm. How long, I wondered, could this thing last? But the age of miracles, it hadn't passed.
Thank you. So, first of all, I want to thank ABC for following me and haunting me with Howard Cosell on my trail, wherever I went. I want to thank Howard, I want to thank you for all that we did together. And also, I want you to remember that I made you in this country. I told my wife 20 years is a long time for a station to stay on television. She said, 26 years is a long time for you to be boxing. I think I won the gold medal. You couldn't cover my Olympic year because that was in 1960. We knew nothing about you then, Howard. But I want to thank all of you for everything. It seems impossible that life went by so quick. I always heard old people say how time flies, and now I'm considered an old man. I'm now 46 years old. You believe it, don't you? No, I'm joking. So thank you all very much for all your participation. Thank you for following me and supporting me, and I hope you have 20 more good years.
Muhammad, thank you very much for everything you gave us through those years. Some of the greatest thrills, some of the greatest moments, and some of the most natively intelligent and incisive and humorous comments we've ever heard from an athlete. You've been great.
A little bit later on, we'll be reviewing the career of Muhammad with Howard Cosell.
Bill Russell defined athletic artistry in the 1956 Olympics. And now he's been commissioned by Budweiser to create a painting to help raise funds for our Olympic team.
You get on the Budweiser Art Series and help our athletes train now for the gold in 84. And remember, the secret to fine art is ball control.
Call toll-free for more information on this art series from Budweiser, proud sponsor of the 1984 Olympic Games.
Vitalis says it's true. A man has to keep himself under control.
I've just been transferred from Hawaii to Alaska, but I'm under control.
He lost the Ferguson account, the Jones account, and his wife ran away with his partner.
But I'm under control.
For every type and style of hair, Vitalis has a product specially designed to give you a terrific natural look you can keep under control all day.
4,000 feet, 3,000 feet, 2,000 feet.
But I'm under control.
Who says it's true? Vitalis says it's true.
Tonight, the Love Boat takes off on a special 90-minute cruise at 9:30, 8:30 Central and Mountain.
You're the Pepsi generation. Catch that Pepsi spirit.
John Silver's, now you can have your fish and chicken too.
Long John Silver's fish and chicken dinner. Crispy fish fillet and chicken planks. Whole meat from the breast of the chicken.
Now you can have your fish and chicken too.
A winner of a dinner and a winner of a prize.
Long John Silver's, now you can have your fish and chicken too.
Don't forget to turn your clock ahead 1 hour tonight.
You're celebrating with us at a dinner for Wide World of Sports' 20th anniversary. People have converged on New York to be with us for this occasion. People who make us remember. Mr. and Mrs. Herb Brooks. Remember the U.S. hockey team? The great miler, Jim Ryan. Here's a lady making her first appearance on Wide World, but she's been with us all the way. O.J. Simpson makes us think of speed and runs like the one you're about to see in the Hula Bowl, 1969, prophetic of the runs to come in his professional career. Chris Schenkel called it that day.
At the 16, 20. Look out! O.J. Yards, ladies and gentlemen.
In the exciting world of speed, this was 20-year-old Jim Ryan setting a world mile record that would stand for 7 years.
Two turns to go. How strong does that kick look, Jimmy? It doesn't look bad, does it?
Jim, it's been strong the whole way, so it's hard to tell. He did accelerate coming around the turn.
The entire crowd on its feet as Jim Ryan pounds for home.
O.J. and Ryan were both Wide World of Sports Athletes of the Year. And so is Don Scholander for his four gold medals in the Tokyo Olympics 1964. Don Scholander, the blonde marvel from the state of Oregon. All he did was set 13 world records back in the middle 1960s. Believe it or not, he's now 35. Don Scholander.
Thank you very much, Jim. I didn't fully appreciate it at the time, but it's always fun to go back in history and relive some wonderful moments like that. Congratulations to you and everyone at ABC Wide World of Sports. You've given us 20 years of wonderful sports broadcasting journalism. And a special thanks, too, for covering sports such as swimming and gymnastics, for without you, the moments would not have been nearly so sweet. Thank you very much for having me here tonight.
Mark Spitz broke or equaled 32 world records, and of course, his 7 Olympic golds in Munich probably never will be equaled. Spitz of California. Donna DeVerona was an early heroine of Wide World of Sports, a star in every swimming stroke, an Olympic gold medalist. Seen here from ABC's innovative underwater camera. A generation later came the young Tracy Calkins, the youngest winner of the Sullivan Award at age 16. She's won more national championship races than any other woman, and as many as Johnny Weissmuller himself. Talk about speed, we saw Secretariat run, the first Triple Crown winner in a quarter century. We watched Spectacular Bid as he won the Bluegrass Stakes. Later, of course, he took the Derby and Preakness and an all-time money-winning record. The Bid. The explosive speed sport of drag racing and terror at 200 miles an hour reported by Keith Jackson.
Nichols off first.
Jim Nichols' car has literally been sawed in half.
Well, as it turned out, Nichols' injuries were minor. But Don Prudhomme didn't know it at the time.
I think I'm quick.
Oh, my God, I seen that car go by me. I couldn't believe it. There was no back. There's no back section on it or nothing.
But Don Prudhomme raced again and races still at the top of his sport. When she first came along, they called her Cha-Cha, but today she's the world champion, the first woman to reach the top of her sport competing against men, and prefers her given name of Shirley, in the lane nearest the camera.
Off they go, and Coletta gets the jump, but he swivels sideways. And it's Shirley! Shirley Muldowney wins it!
Speed begets danger, as when Cale Yarborough mixed it up with Sam McQuag in Turn 1 at Darlington 16 years ago. Ended up out of the racetrack, in the parking lot, but right side up and uninjured. Maynard Troyer at Daytona, rolling some 18 times, but again, coming out of it with hardly a scratch. Even Richard Petty, the greatest stock car driver of them all, was not immune from danger. The man who's nearing 200 career victories had a near thing in this crash, but again it was tribute to the strength of the American racing stock car that he was racing again in just a few weeks. But Richard's achievements far outweigh the setbacks. He has taken 7 Grand National Season Championships, an unequaled mark. He has won the fabled Daytona 500 no less than 7 times. So they call him King Richard. We've seen speed in the streets of Monte Carlo, as when Phil Hill chased Bruce McLaren in the rain in 1962.
It looks like McLaren can hold it at this point, so they're very near the end. This is the last turn that he has to make. Here comes McLaren. Watch how close they are. They clip that corner, almost touching the wall. The difference is going to be less than a second and a half. McLaren is across the finish line, and here comes Phil Hill. McLaren is the winner. Phil Hill is in second place. He loses by 1 3/10 seconds.
We saw the late Jim Clark and gave him our Athlete of the Year Award for 1965.
I'm really overwhelmed by this great honor, which ABC, I feel, not only do me this evening, but do the world of motor racing in general. I take this honor not only as a personal award, but also as an award for each and every one of us in the motor racing field.
Jim Clark of Scotland, one of the greats of motorsport, twice a World Grand Prix champion, winner of the Indianapolis 500, later died on the race course in Germany. Jackie Stewart not only won at Monte Carlo, but became a local hero there and a friend of the reigning couple, Princess Grace, once of Philadelphia, and her prince, Renier. Jackie was three-time world champion, winner of more Grand Prix races than anyone else. But not everybody knew that in South Carolina. After he retired, he went there with us as a commentator and found out the sad truth.
Who's your favorite driver?
Bobby Allison.
Yeah? Do you know who Jackie Stewart is?
I guess the guy you said.
You sang?
Yeah.
The American, is he an American driver?
I believe he is, I don't know.
Yet another man of speed was our athlete of 1969, Mario Andretti, winner of Indy in that year, and in 1978, the world driving champion. Like Jackie Stewart, Mario's with us for Wide World's birthday party in New York.
You know, as I look around, my eyes really feast for what I see. I don't think you could ever find more diversified or as much a diversified group of talent under one roof from every possible sport that you can think of and every possible walk of life. And for this, I think we have got to thank an ABC Wide World Sports. Thank you.
Thank you, Mario.
Of all the pickups in the market today, one carries them all. It's the leader, Ford. With the best gas mileage ratings of all the American-built pickups that can carry a big 2,500-pound payload. With more six-cylinder torque than any of them do. And as for the imports, Ford's got them in roominess as well as payload. And now check out Ford's base price compared with the little imports. Yes, for total value, Ford carries them all. It's America's best-selling pickup.
Tough truck deals are in the air. Check them out now during the Ford Truck Sales Drive.
Fortunately, the man who owns this business is covered by Continental Insurance. We're experts at lowering risks, which can also lower premiums. We found that the way he stored his chemicals could have been deadly. We advised a new, safer way. And this disaster never happened. Maybe we can stop something from happening to you. Call a Continental agent about your business or home.
I like to think I made football a better game to play because I introduced a whole new concept of professional defense. Root 33 antiperspirant stick deodorant. It helps keep you dry and it gives you long-lasting deodorant protection. And it has a great smell of Root. That's why pro football is putting a lot more emphasis on defense. And there are a lot fewer offensive players.
Make every day your Brute Day with Root 33 deodorants and antiperspirants.
Tomorrow, ABZ stands for action. National Championship Sprint Car Racing on one of the wildest tracks in the country. Plus surfing slides and glides, daring drivers and super surfers. Tomorrow on ABZ's Wide World of Sports.
We're back again at the 20th anniversary party for ABC's Wide World of Sports in the Grand Ballroom of the Waldorf Astoria Hotel in New York. You know, all of the personalities we've met along the way have not been athletes. In fact, some of them have been our own colleagues, people like Bill Fleming, who was on the very first Wide World of Sports, Frank Gifford, a longtime colleague now, Keith Jackson. Al Michaels joined us just a few years ago, but he sure made his place with us. Chris Schenkel, Jim Lampley, and the truly inimitable and ineffable, I might say, my friend of more than 20 years, Howard Cosell, who not only has done a lot of good interviews and heartbreaking, fast-breaking stories on Wide World of Sports, but particularly boxing, and even more particularly than that, that association with an incredible man named Muhammad Ali.
True, Jim. Ali was transcendental a sport. In a decade of turbulence and turmoil, he emerged as a figure with historic implications, economically, politically, sociologically, and even legally. So we had the good fortune to present his continuing saga. It really began when he was a brash kid named Cassius Clay in 1964 in Miami Beach against Charles Sonny Liston. The heavyweight championship at stake. Liston, the overwhelming favorite. But Clay slid his face apart and Liston could not come out for the seventh round. Then Ali, because that's what his name became, said, "My name is Muhammad Ali." In Lewiston, Maine in 65. The invisible punch in the first round of the rematch. The kids from Bates College storming down the ringside, screaming, "Fix, fix, fix." Jersey Joe Walcott, the referee. The count going to 24. And the late Nat Fleischer telling Walcott the fight was over. I ain't got nothing against them Viet Cong. Thus did Ali speak, so he had to go overseas to fight a series of fights. That one against the Blackpool blockbuster Brian London. But back to America he came in the autumn and at his positive greatest simply destroyed Cleveland Williams. Throughout his career, always quick of wit.
Are you taking Zora Foley too lightly?
Why would you say that?
Because every indication has been that you're confident that you can beat Zora.
I'm confident I can whip all of them. This ain't nothing new. My image is being confident. What you trying to make it look like something new for? I'm always confident I can whip all of them.
You're being extremely truculent.
Whatever truculent mean, if that's good, I'm there.
Count me out, said the champ. I won't go. He rejected military induction April 28, 1967 in Houston, Texas. Made his feelings plain this way.
Whatever the punishment, whatever the persecution is for standing up for my religious beliefs, even if it means facing machine gun fire that day, I will face it before denouncing Elijah Muhammad and the religion of Islam. I'm ready to die.
He never had to forfeit his convictions. He was vindicated by the Supreme Court of the United States on the comeback trail. March 8, 1971, the Old Garden, the first fight against Joe Frazier. And Ali would lose for the first time in his professional boxing career. Lose the decision. This 15th round action shows you why. Tremendous left hook. Still, Ali had the capacity to get up and to fight on. But it was too late for him. Earlier, he had been staggered all over the ring by an 11th round left hook like that one. It didn't floor him. Another comeback attempt necessary, another stumbling block, Kenny Norton.
A countdown for the end of the fight. Ali's mouth is bloody, the left gets in, and a good right. He is all over Ali. He is punching him around the ring. One could believe in miracles. Norton himself is tired. You just saw him groping for breath against the ropes, but he knows what he's doing here. Maybe there is something in hypnotism because it's worked for Kenny Norton today.
The decision for Norton, a broken jaw for Ali. Then Ali and Frazier visited our studios while preparing for their fight number two and to analyze their fight number one.
He won't bring up the hospital. What
difference? Why'd you bring up the hospital?
I went to the hospital.
Why? Why you figure I'm
eager? I went to the hospital.
Why you think I'm eager?
You know, sit down.
Yeah. Sit down,
Joe.
Why you think I'm eager?
Sit down, Joe.
Huh?
Sit down quick.
Why you think I'm eager?
The brothers are here.
Doing this too?
No. Sit down quick, Joe.
Well, we're having a scene, as you can see, and it's hard to tell whether it's clowning or for real between the two fighters. This kind of thing has been going on all along in terms of promotion of a fight, and this time it seems to be for real, because Joe Frazier is really angry. I think that Ali is probably clowning, but there is no question in my mind that Joe Frazier is not clowning. They threw off their respective earpieces, microphones. Joe Frazier's watch came off. There was a wrestling bout on the floor, and we're really very sorry this happened.
Just a few days later, they fought again in the Old Garden. Frazier, you'll remember, had lost the title of foreman. This time, Ali prevailed, winning a decision unanimously in 12 rounds. After that, the chance to recapture the title. Kinshasa's our ear. The rope-a-dope game against a George Foreman who punched himself out, quickly tired, and was finally knocked out by Muhammad Ali. So he had executed the comeback miracle. He had recaptured the heavyweight championship of the world. For Ali, in many ways, it was a triumph comparable to his comeback against Joe Frazier in the non-title bout victory, because none had believed he could beat Foreman. Then came the thriller in Manila, the last, the third time around between these two great warriors, Muhammad Ali and Joe Frazier. Joe would tell me later, I hit him with blows that would have crumbled walls and the man wouldn't go down. Ali would say after the 10th round,
this was the closest thing to death I had ever felt. But you're looking at 14th round action. Ali still somehow able to punch, clearly tired. Joe's eyes cut almost beyond belief. The fighters went to their corners. Joe Frazier to be closely watched. Ali sitting there, obviously exhausted. Joe's eyes all but closed. Eddie Futch, the manager, caring about his fighter, telling Joe he was not going to let him go out there. Joe saying, no, no, let me go out. Let me go out. But Futch turning around, telling the referee, Carlos Padilla, I am not letting him go out. Joe still begging to go out. Ali standing up the victor. It was one of the greatest fights of all time. A classic fight. It'll be remembered always, and that's the way Ali will be remembered. That's the way he looks now, and the question is now, will there be anybody to take his place? Well, maybe not in the heavyweight division, but there's another kid around. Sugar Ray Leonard became the welterweight champion of the world, and then on June 20th, 1980, at Montreal, he defended against Roberto Duran. 30 seconds left in this bout. Duran with two good quick lefts and a third left. Sugar Ray fighting back. But did you see the way Duran kept moving his head? Left, right, bobbing, weaving. Now Duran taunting him. Yeah, here's my chin. Hit it, hit it. Look at Duran walking around. He thinks he's got the fight in the bag. That much is clear from his point of view. And so the end of the fight. Duran won it, a unanimous decision. But then the rematch. The now famous Nomas story as Duran quit before Sugar Ray Leonard. Sugar Ray Leonard looks like that now, and they love him. He is in the image of Muhammad Ali.
Michelob brings you the 7-day weekend, all America style. Americans love weekends, not just the Saturday and Sunday kind, but whenever we take time to enjoy the good things in life, like the smooth and mellow taste of Michelob. Because all over America, Michelob helps make any time feel a little like a weekend.
Hey, put a little weekend in your week.
Yeah.
Fact, every time you start your car, you burn more than gas, you burn money. Gas money. Because gas-robbing friction steals miles from your car and money from your pocket. What can you do? Fact, use the black motor oil Arco Graphite. The oil with graphite. The oil that gives you the best gas mileage of any other leading oil. Drive further for less gas money with Arco Graphite. The oil that's fact, not friction. Look for Arco Graphite's $1.80 refund offer.
One winter's day in 1970, in Oberstdorf, West Germany, an athlete put on a performance that in time would mean he would appear more often on Wide World of Sports than anyone else. He appears, in fact, every single week. Now, we've seen many thrills of victory here tonight. Now, one more time, let's look at the moment that personifies the agony of defeat. His name is Vinko Bogataj. His jump was described that day by Bud Palmer and Art Devlin. Remember, Bud?
Now we go to Vinko Bogataj, the Yugoslavian, the youngster. His inexperience, he fell on his first jump.
A lot of speed in that track.
Now, look out!
Look at him go! Oh! Now, let me dispel a few rumors. Vinko Bogataj not only lives, but is here with us tonight. Vinko. Vinko not only came all the way from his home country to be with us tonight, but I'm told that his wife, now here's an irony for you, he got a slight concussion in that jump. His wife had a fairly serious back problem over the weekend, but she still hung in there, went to the hospital, came back. Vinko, we can't thank you and your wife enough. If you'd like, as I said, he only got a slight concussion. He did jump later, and he jumped very well, was an outstanding Yugoslavian athlete. Today, he lives in his hometown. He works in a factory that makes anchor chain. He lives very happily with his family, and he's an outstanding landscape artist and a sculptor. He is quite a man, is Vinko, and we can't thank him enough again for coming here tonight. One moment remains here. The 1980 Athlete of the Year Award. For the first time, it was given to a team rather than an individual. A team that took on a group personality as they scored what stands in my mind as the greatest upset perhaps in the history of sport, certainly the greatest in Olympics history. But it was more than the simple victory. By their manner of winning, they repopularized some words that had fallen into disuse in certain quarters in recent years. Words like hope and faith and dedication and love. That's right. These tough young men came right out and said that one of the key reasons for their triumph was their love for each other. None of us will ever forget them, nor will we forget the words of Al Michaels and Ken Dryden as they described the miracle of Lake Placid by the athletes of 1980, the United States Olympic hockey team.
19 seconds. Johnson over to Ramsey. The Legionov gets checked by Ramsey. McClanahan is there. The puck is still loose. 11 seconds. You've got 10 seconds. The countdown going on right now. Morrow up to Silk.
We'll never forget Jim Craig in the moment of ultimate triumph, wondering where his father was. First things first. Said. Now,
Some of the members of that team are still playing in this year's NHL playoffs, where so many of them have distinguished themselves as American pros. Some of the others are playing in the World Championships, now going on in Sweden. But the others are here with us. And as I said, when Mike went like this, we'd like to do it one more time. For Eric Strobel. Come on up. For Buzz Schneider. For Mark Wells. Come on up here. For the man whom we'll never forget, mouthing the words, "Where's my father?" Goalie Jim Craig. For the captain of Team USA, Mike Arruzioni. And for the only man, because of the rules of the Olympics, who did not receive a gold medal, Coach Herb Brooks. Said, because of the rules of the games, you were the only guy who didn't get a gold medal. This is the thing that's emblematic of this Athlete of the Year championship. It's awarded every year. We'd like to give this to you in honor of your team, the dedication, as you were saying to me down here, the physical fitness, I think you had the nerve to say, the work ethic that made this country great. Would you just say something to us now?
Thank you, Jim. ABC, ladies and gentlemen. To all the great individual athletes that are in attendance tonight, and not to diminish your immense accomplishments and your achievements and your God-given talents, I'd like to thank ABC because for the first time in history, a team in any sport, in any time, has won this award, won the Sports Illustrated Award, won all the major sporting awards in the country, save one, and an outstanding individual, a comrade of ours, and a man that we admire so much, Mr. Eric Heiden, who is here tonight. I'd like to just say that the intangibles, that the spirit of a team, the power that we all can generate when we work together as a unit, these are some of the intangibles and values that our team took from our country. And for 2 weeks, 20 unusual, uncommon, unique young people showed the world that our way of life and our system and our people have made us the greatest nation on the earth. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Herb. We have a plaque like this for every member of the team. We'll give them to the fellows who are here. Right now it has a picture of that moment of victory and an inscription and the Wide World of Sports patch. Jimmy.
Thank you very much.
Congratulations. Awesome. Yeah. I want you. One extra. And finally to the captain of Team USA, and I'm going to ask him to respond for the other guys, Mike Arruzioni.
Thank you. Everyone wants to know how the United States won a gold medal in hockey. And we won it because we loved each other. And we respected each other. And we admired each other. And it just proves that old theory and that old cliche that I guess my dad taught me and Herb's dad taught him and Jimmy's dad taught him and every one of my teammates, that if you believe in something and you accomplish and you believe in each other and respect each other, that you can win. And that's all we were, Dan. We weren't the best team, but I'll tell you, we were the proudest team, and we won. Thank you.
Constant variety of sport. The thrill of victory. And the agony of defeat. The human drama of athletic competition. We hope you've enjoyed these first 20 years of ABC's Wide World of Sports.
This special 20th anniversary edition of ABC's Wide World of Sports has been brought to you by Ford and your local Ford dealer, who invites you to test drive the EXP, America's new personal sports coupe. Tomorrow is here from the world of Ford. Travel arrangements were made through and a promotional fee paid by United Airlines. United flies more people to Hawaii than any other airline. That's what friendly skies are all about.
20 weeks became 20 years, and still more tomorrows lie ahead. We hope you'll continue the journey with us, because we truly believe that the best is yet to come.
The best is yet to come, baby.